Once again, good evening, everybody. Welcome, everybody, to our February 2nd, 2017 Board of Education Workshop. We are going to begin the evening with some student presentations. I'm going to turn the floor over to our Superintendent of Schools, Mr. Michael Brooks.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out. Let's jump right in, since we have a good number of students to recognize tonight, with student of the month, from the high school. Let's start with the high school.
Thank you, Mr. Brooks. As always, it's an honor to do this. So what I'd like to do is call up Mrs. Hastings. Come on up. And our student of the month in the Fine Arts Department, Nina Guido. Come on up, Nina.
Good evening, everyone. Stay right here. So Nina Guido, who is a senior, I have two words. Well, maybe three words. Four words. Talent and work ethic. Strong talent, strong work ethic, an amazing student that I've had for 4 years. She has been passionate. She has been nonstop with her work, and she works all summer. This is a self-portrait that she did. Nina, I had Nina when she was a freshman, and I saw an amazing, the work ethic came through even as a freshman, but not just the work ethic, but also the spark that she had for art. I knew that she would go very far with her talent. So she was the second freshman ever that I welcomed into AP Studio Art, which is a college course. And she received a 4 out of 5 on her portfolio when she was a sophomore. That's pretty amazing. Last year, she received a 4 out of 5. This year, she's going to receive a 5, I know. And Nina is also very amazingly helpful to all of the newbies in AP Art. She takes them under her wing and helps them out with their different projects. She's a member of the National Honor Society, the Spanish Honor Society. She's received numerous scholastic awards every year, including 5 silver and numerous honorable mentions this year. Also, scholar awards in other subjects. And her rigorous schedule is also made up of college and honors classes, and she's president of the yearbook this year, the yearbook club. One of the things that I want to mention are the obstacles that she's overcome, personal obstacles in her life, in order to be the person that she wants to be. She has been through many things in her young life that a normal person would just kind of sit down and give up. But she did just the opposite. She climbed that mountain. And she is going to the School of Visual Arts in September. And she's going to become an illustrator and a graphic designer. And I'm so, so proud of her. And I don't want her to go, but I want her to succeed tremendously and see her name up there in lights. So, Nina, I give you a big hand. Love you. Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Keep up the great work and good luck in college.
Thank you.
Hi, how are you?
Let's move right down the ladder and go to the middle school, Ms. Clinton.
Thanks.
Good evening. Well, thank you. And it's wonderful to see so many students here to celebrate tonight. But in particular, we're very excited to recognize our middle school student of the month on behalf of the Foreign Language Department. Mrs. Sedgwick is going to present Amaya White.
Good evening. Amaya White is a seventh grader in my third period Spanish class. The fact that she currently has the highest average of all of my seventh graders, 68 students, is truly not the reason why I chose her to be the student of the month. But rather, there are two qualities that define who she is, and those just can't be taught in the classroom. First, she has an intrinsic need, a true desire to do well. She pushes herself to be the best that she can be. She asks great questions, and she strives to make sense of everything that we do. That quality will be far more important in her life ever than her GPA. Secondly, she has heart. She is a kind, considerate, and a great role model for her peers. And honestly, she's just simply a lovely young lady. So it is for these reasons that the World Language Department is so very proud to have chosen La Señorita Amaya White as our Student of the Month.
Thank you, darling. I'm so glad you came. I was worried you weren't going to show up.
And the elementary school, Mrs. Walsh, there she is.
Thank you, Mr. Brooks. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to an exciting night. We love to honor our students of the month. Marlboro Elementary School is going to back it up a little because our January student of the month had a drama commitment and was unable to join us. So right now, Mr. Budrick is going to introduce Liliana Bonfante, and she was our January student of the month.
All right, this is Lily. And Lily is a kind and caring young lady. Not only does she get exceptional grades in school, but she also shows the PBIS characteristics of pride every day. Lily consistently shows patience, respect, integrity, determination, and excellence in school. She's a great student, and I'm very proud of her. Lily works well with others. She's kind and caring to both her peers and adults in our school. When working with a partner in the classroom, she's always using kind words, and she encourages them. She's also very eager to volunteer. She always raises her hand to answer questions or to read aloud in class, and Lily consistently goes above and beyond. She's always an active participant, and she loves learning. She's also a very talented young actress, which is why she couldn't be here last month. She's involved in the theater company from stage to screen, and she was recently seen performing in the production of The Lion King. Her confidence as a performer transfers into the classroom as well. When Lily reads aloud, she reads clearly and with great expression. Well, when we were reading a short play in our guided reading group, her classmates were actually quite impressed with her ability to read the different parts like the characters would sound. It's easy to tell that Lily is a natural performer. Lily, you should be very proud of what you've accomplished so far in third grade. You're a well-rounded student, and your kindness, your talents shine in and out of school. This is why you were recommended for Student of the Month. Keep up the good work. Know that your hard work makes your teachers, your parents, your school, and your community proud. Congratulations.
Thank you. Congratulations again to Lily, and thank you very much, Mr. Budrick. It's now our pleasure again. I can speak on behalf of Marlboro Elementary School, and we're going to introduce Nicole Louise Aguilar from Ms. Taddeo's class, and she will tell you why Nicole is our Student of the Month for February.
As you can see just from what her friends say, Nicole is a magnificent student. One of the many special things about Nicole, too, she is bilingual and speaks both Spanish and English. So I will be going, I'm going to talk quick, but I'm going to go back and forth a little just so Mom and Dad can hear all the wonderful things about her as well. So Nicole is a student who is always working hard, putting her best foot forward, and has a heart that is larger than my body. Nicole es una estudiante que trabaja duro, que es cuidadosa y inteligente. Siempre trata de dar lo mejor de sí misma y tiene un corazón muy grande. When her friends, any of her friends, are having a rough day, she comes in the next day with some kind of intricate craft or letter, which obviously she has to go home and actually think about these things and takes time out of her free night to make something for her friends, which I think is one of the most admirable traits of her. Cuando sus amigas y amigas se sienten mal, Nicole trata por todos los medios de hacer que se sienten mejor. Es admirable la empatía para ella demuestra, ella verdaderamente única y excepcional. Estoy muy orgullosa de ella, which means I'm proud of her today, and I will be proud of her forever. Thank you.
So just in case you weren't paying attention, what does it take to be a student of the month? You need to be talented, amazing, passionate. You need to overcome obstacles. You need to be heartful and have a kind heart. Be prideful, have integrity, be intelligent, encouraging, volunteer, friend, be empathetic, and also be one in a million. So students of the month, we love you. Thank you very much. And we also have a presentation for the Reflections winners from the elementary school. And Ms. Bogacic, I believe, is here for that presentation. Yes, right there. So let's pass the baton and get moving on that side. So thank you.
Thank you. So we're very happy tonight to talk to you a little bit about our Reflections program at the Mauerville Elementary School. Reflections is an arts program. It's sponsored by the National PTA. And it encourages students in grades K through 12 to express themselves in a number of different creative ways. Each year there's a new theme for our program, and this year's theme was What's Your Story? So many students from Marlboro Elementary School decided to participate, and we had submissions in all sorts of categories. This year we had everything from photography to literature to musical composition for the very first time. So our program's growing, which is wonderful. It's really important to note that the children that participate in Reflections choose to do so. This is not a classroom assignment or something they have to do, but instead something that, in addition to all of the responsibilities they have, they choose to take on so that they can grow and better themselves in this way. This year's participants expressed themselves in many categories, and all of their entries were judged by an independent panel of judges, which is out of our district and actually out of our county. They're from Dutchess County. There are writers and artists that judge each submission and determine which submissions are winners for our school. While I would love to share the artwork with you tonight, all of it is actually at the regional level being judged. At this time, I do know that we actually have one submission this year that is representing Marlboro Elementary School at the state level. So I would be very happy to specifically recognize that little girl in just a moment. When you hear your name announced, if Reflections winners could just come up in front of the Board of Education, we have a few of them, so I don't know how well they'll fit over here. So, and if we could just come right up there, and then I will recognize you, okay? So the first one, who is going to States this year, is Adeline Appler, and she is a winner for Primary Visual Arts. Congratulations, Adeline. Adeline was actually a double winner in visual arts. She had two submissions that both won in that category. We also had Emily Height for intermediate visual arts. Emma LaPola for intermediate visual arts. Gianna Ferricellia for Special Artist Visual Arts. Angelina Ferricellia for Special Artist Visual Arts. Moving on to our photography category, Miles Giosante for primary photography. I mentioned before that Adeline was a double winner in visual arts. She also won in our primary photography category as well. So great job, Adeline. And as if one artist in the family wasn't enough, we have her brother, Gabriel Appler, who won for intermediate photography. Paige Ballou for intermediate photography. Lex Antonelli for special artist photography. Fiona DeBenedictis for primary literature. Robert Kunkel for intermediate literature. Emma Bogacik for intermediate literature. And last but certainly not least, our very first award recipient for musical composition, Katherine Greiner.
And finally, with a night of celebration, we have our spelling bee winners. So Mrs. Hecht is prepared to tell us who our spelling bee winners are.
Ms. Messina, can you join me since you helped me organize this?
Thank you.
This is our 18th year of holding the spelling bee here at Marlboro Central School District. The spelling bee itself started in 1925, and they estimate about 11 million students across the U.S. this year taking part in the spelling bee. We had 200 students take the written spelling bee, and then those students moved on to take the oral spelling bee. And of those students, we have six that we will award tonight, and two will be going to the Capital Region in Schenectady, New York, to compete against about 200 students. And the winner of that contest will go to Washington, D.C. with a all-inclusive family paid trip. So, pretty exciting. So our winners, our first place winner, who's a second year winner, is Harrison Solomon. He's a fifth grader from MES. And do you want to do the Marlboro Middle School?
Oh. Our Marlboro. Our Marlboro Middle School winner is seventh grader Gianna Barbaro.
Gianna, do you remember the word? What was it?
Prestidigitation.
You want to spell that word?
No, but say the word again, because it blows my mind every time you say it, because it's nice and loud so they can hear. In case you didn't hear, prestidigitation, and she had to spell it twice. The judges were unclear the first time.
Solomon, do you remember yours? Do you remember? What was that? Pilgrimages, right. They were difficult words, right? We went round and round at the end, over and over, because they were spelling them correctly. So our second place winner was Holden West. Is Holden here tonight? I didn't think I saw him. Okay, he's swimming, all right.
And our Marlboro Middle School winner is Jaisal Patel.
And third place at Marlboro Elementary, Claire Devine.
And our third place at the Marlboro Middle School was Juliana Durant.
Congratulations, everyone. Well done.
Before I give everybody a moment to step out, I'd like to make note of item number 5 on this evening's agenda, which will be a budget review by our district business office. So if anybody is interested in hearing how the budget process is going and where we stand financially, tonight would be a good night to stick around. However, understandably, I know some of you need to get your children home to bed for school tomorrow, so we're going to take a quick 4-minute recess and let everybody make their way to the door. Thank you all for coming. Congratulations again to all our evening's winners. We're going to get back on track. We're going to get back started with a public comment on this evening's agenda items. If you have any questions or comments on this evening's agenda items, could you please approach the podium, speak into the microphone, state your name and town, and address the Board of Education. Any questions, comments on this evening's agenda items? With that, we're going to move on to our superintendent's report for the evening. Again, turn over the floor to Mr. Michael Brooks.
Thank you, Mr. Bell. Yes, tonight begins our process for 2017-2018 with our school budget development. We've now been working on, at district office, the budget for 17-18 for about a month in basic deliberations, but really started more in-depth development of budget last week. And last week, a small group of us started meeting with principals and looking at requests and proposals. We met with directors to talk about options that are out there. And then today, we had a nice long session to really start digging into what will eventually become a superintendent's proposed budget for the Board of Education. One of the things I like to do in the process of developing a budget for the board to consider is to, as much as possible from a pure perspective, develop a true program focus for what we would like to see the school district move towards, and not look at the economics during that part of the discussion. Let's not look at how much things cost or what we'll be able to get or not get because of whatever economics we're faced with. It allows us to then have a true open dialogue over real wants, needs, as far as what we would like to present for our children. And we did that today. Then we start to get into more of a sobering moment where we look at the realities of what we can and what we can't do. And that's something that will happen over the next several weeks as the board considers what we will eventually propose to them. Tonight really serves as a key piece in the foundation of where we would like to see ourselves go, but more importantly, where we can see ourselves go from an economic perspective. Now, it blows me away each time Mr. Witherow shows me these charts, but he has a series of Excel charts that are so in-depth and so interconnected that it boggles my mind that it's almost like the Wizard of Oz sitting behind a set of screens and he can just toggle a couple of switches and change a couple of numbers and whammo, there's the budget figures. And it's not a simple process, I can assure you that. There's lots of tabs, lots of different charts, lots of different spreadsheets that just interconnect and become what you're going to see tonight. So I would like to pass the torch off to Patrick and encourage him to talk to us about our long-term financial projection. You'll recognize this from the last couple of years. I believe he actually has a slide from last year to make some year-to-year comparisons. But really, this helps us get an idea from a long-term perspective. Are we heading in the right direction? The board did get information from the comptroller's office regarding our financial stress health. It's something that the comptroller put in place for school districts and municipalities a number of years ago to test their financial stress level and how they can handle difficulties that are plaguing communities. And we performed very, very well in our financial stress review by the comptroller's office. So I'd like to say, before Patrick really gets himself going, that he's done a nice job shepherding us through some very difficult scenarios, and I'm appreciative of the work he puts into all of this and his detailed approach. So thank you, Pat. I appreciate that.
Sure.
When we're done with Pat's part, I would like to ask the board if there are concepts, items, areas, projections that you would like to have us assure we are presenting in a budget package, or at least addressing and working towards. That would be a great time for it. Right after Pat's discussion would be a good time to have some dialogue to give us some parameters. So I'd appreciate and encourage that kind of dialogue. So Pat, it's
okay. Thank you.
It's all you.
So just as an overview, the numbers we're going to see tonight are kind of big picture numbers with the intent to kind of forecast out into the future. So we have an idea of really where we're heading. when we get through the budget process and towards the end, probably, you know, around when we would present to the board a budget for adoption for consideration, we'll look to update these numbers again. Because we're still, as Mr. Brooks had mentioned, we're still compiling all this information so that we can firm these numbers up. And, you know, as I've talked about in previous years, you know, we start with a pretty wide net, and then we just work and continuously narrow until we're very comfortable with what our numbers represent in terms of accuracy and how it reflects the needs of the educational program. So it's fairly brief, but there's a lot of detail. So if at any point the board has any questions, please jump in, and we can ask some questions at the end also. So the first thing I wanted to do is just run through what our state aid numbers look like right now. And this is based off of the governor's proposal. Oftentimes, by the time the legislature gets done, we see improvement in these numbers. So we're hopeful that that will continue, although the numbers look pretty good as they are. You may have noticed, anybody who looked at the overall numbers and what the percentages were, they saw Marlboro did pretty well. And that's good, because we've suffered for a number of years, and we finally reached the point where we had projected that we would see bumps in state aid, and we're actually seeing the bumps in state aid. It's important to note that the 16-17 are budgeted numbers, not actuals, and the 17-18 are based off of the governor's proposal. So you see foundation aid, slight increase. Now, I think if we were fully funded, and Joanne, you had that information today, you know, if we were fully funded on foundation aid, that number would be closer to about $12 million. So you can see we're still severely underfunded in terms of what the initial formula was meant to accomplish. So we did see an increase, though. The biggest section that we see here, and again, it's from budgeted to proposed, is building aid. Building aid went up significantly. Transportation's up, BOCES aid is up nicely, excess cost aid is up a bit, and textbook, I think that 161, the budgeted number, might have been off, as we see a significant decrease there, but I'm going to look into that and see why we have that discrepancy. But overall, you know, from last year's numbers budgeted to this year's projected, we see about a $2.1 million increase. Now, it's important to note the transportation aid, or I'm sorry, the building aid, has a significant impact on our levy capacity. So when we get additional building aid as part of the levy calculation, there's an exclusion for capital expenditures. And one of our capital expenditures is our debt service net of state aid. So when state aid increases, our debt service net of state aid decreases. And that decrease has an impact when we go through the calculation in terms of removing the capital levy numbers in the beginning of the equation and reinstating them in the end after some computations take place in between. And I had showed, and at some point in a future presentation, we can throw that calculation up there again and walk through it. We've seen it a couple times. It's fairly confusing, but I have it broken out nicely in a spreadsheet that works out well. So it is, you know, we're happy with these numbers, and we'll see, but we're not surprised, because we expected this to occur. So you can see, going back probably to the 14-15 school year, we had projected forward what we had hoped our state aid would be, and we had projected increases in 16-17 and 17-18, and you can see our actual increases came in a little bit better than that, which is great. We always take a somewhat conservative approach when we're dealing with any of these numbers, in the hopes that we wind up in this situation where we actually receive more money than what we had anticipated. Because we'll plan on having less. When we have more, it works out a lot better, as you'll see. So this was our projection from last year at this time. And just a couple things to note. Really, realistically, we were concerned about our reserves and our fund balance. So you can see we have an allocation, considerable allocation of reserves projected out as of last year. And you can see our overall impact. While we maintained through the 21-22 school year, we retained our 4% fund balance, our reserves dropped considerably to under $1 million, under $600,000. So, you know, obviously concerning, because you know, ultimately that money will disappear and we'll have nothing to plug the hole up on the revenue side. But because of a number of factors, namely the increases in aid, a better than expected 15-16 school year, which left us with additional fund balance at the end of the year, we're able to update our projection, and it looks a little bit like this. So we can see here where initially we were looking at 577,000 in reserves as a projection in 21-22. We now are looking at 4.4 million in 21-22. So there's a number of reasons, a significant one being the additional bumps in aid that we received in 16-17 and 17-18 anticipated. Because as we move forward, those numbers, that base being increased, continues to move forward as we look at, you know, our modest projections moving forward in terms of anticipated increases. So that, combined with the fact that we finished 15-16 in a significantly better position, helped give us that one-time boost in cash, and then the increasing revenues from the state aid, anticipated state aids, puts us in a much better situation. So, you know, I don't want to make the announcement, but it would appear that we've maybe weathered that storm that we've had for a couple of years, because the big concern, you know, was always the valuations of the power plants. We see we have the Dan Scammer projections for the pilot payment. We anticipated a significant bump in the tax rates when the pilot payment kicked in. Fortunately, it kicked in a year earlier than we had anticipated, because that agreement, the way it was actually a six-year pilot agreement, and we were able to absorb that increase in the increased aid last year. So where we had initially at one point projected about 11% increase solely due to this pilot kicking in, we were able to absorb that and still have very reasonable tax rates last year in terms of increases. And one thing that's notable, if you look, in 21-22, when we exit the pilot, our tax cap right now, and this is very far out, very theoretical, because there's a very varied variables that we're just plugging in our current numbers for. Those numbers could be better, they could be worse, but something just to consider for the next couple of years is, you know, what that 6.08, that would be our allowable levy increase in that year, and that's significant. So just to give you something to think about for the next several years until we get there. But overall, I think with the increases that we've seen in aid, we're able to project ourselves out to a much more favorable position. And as you can see, you know, at the bottom when we have the deficit, these are all negative deficits, which means they're surpluses, which is what we expect. As we talk multiple times, you know, we anticipate to use about 96% of our budget, and then we have that other 4%, which is usually about $2 million that just sits as a buffer. And in the past, we've had to, you know, we had to build up our cash position, and we're now at a point where we could just keep allocating those reserves and then hopefully not spending them and have it at the end of the year. So instead of having to tax for that 4%, we've now built our cash position significantly enough that it could just be built in as part of the regular operation. So, you know, we don't need to really seek any additional funds to build that extra, you know, buffer, which is what we talk about all the time. The budget's, you know, projected to be, you know, almost $56 million. So $2 million is a very reasonable amount of money to have, especially with, you know, items like special ed, and where you really can't plan, because, you know, in the summer you could have, you know, a whole classroom of kids move in, and, you know, we have to be able to pay for that. So there's a lot of information on the slides. Is there any questions?
Specifically in the 17-18, so I'm assuming because of the additional building aid, that's why we've got a negative tax cap?
Thank you. Yep, I forgot to mention that. Yes, right now we are projecting that we would have a decrease in our levy. So, and it is because of, you know, essentially what happens is the way the formula works, the state's increasing the building aid, so they in turn say, well, now you don't have to tax for that, so it's going to affect your cap. So it's almost, well, you get the extra building aid, you almost have a, you know, you have a very significant decrease in your levy offset by that. So that's why it's always when the numbers come out and you know, you get calls from whomever saying, your numbers look great, you must be happy. I'm like, well, yeah, we are, but they're not, you know, there's other impacts that are
going to
occur.
Depends on what line they're on.
Exactly. Now, if that was foundation aid, we'd be very happy because that would have no impact. But we are projecting, and if, you know, once we firm that number up, I can almost guarantee it's going to be negative. Excuse me. We just don't know exactly the impact of it being negative. But, you know, to note, that would be three consecutive years of reduction in our tax levy while we've been able to really control the rate of tax increase and maintain a very solid financial position.
Just to give a little bit of perspective, too, there's the different aid categories. Some of those are expense-based aids, which is the majority of the aids that are out there are expense-based aids, meaning you get an allocation based upon a formula, and you expend it to get it back.
Correct.
The one that's based primarily on enrollment and a couple of other minor factors, but it's really primarily based on enrollment, is the foundation aid. So that's the one that you want to get more fully funded because that's true dollars that come to expend on programs that you have in district that aren't a reimbursement aid. It's more of a, here's your check.
Right.
So that's something that is an important aid line when you look at the runs.
And that's historically why, especially this governor, has historically not increased foundation aid, because it looks good that he's giving more money, but it's still doing the backside and then not meeting what the courts dictated many, many moons ago now.
Right. And remember, these numbers are very initial, preliminary. We'll tighten them up, and when we get towards the end of the budget process, we can give an updated projection once we have solid numbers.
Right, the numbers won't be truly finalized until the state adopts a budget, and that is by law April 1st. Mm. It doesn't always hit April 1st. Luckily, for a good number of years, it has been adopted by April 1st. But there's a rush towards the end there. As a matter of fact, in the legislative calendar, education K-12 is not even on the docket for review until the middle of February. So there's some time until we start to see some real action. But the real action for school aid is that last week of March. That's when it really starts to come together.
And you remember last year, the governor didn't release any information initially, so we were kind of running in the blind at this point. But so we're at least better off in that from that perspective. Any other questions? Well, these are right now, these are very theoretical numbers, right? Because there's an allowable levy growth factor that's issued, and then there's the there's the CPI and then the regional adjustment factor. So the regional adjustment breaks out, you know, based on costs across the state. And then, you know, the CPI, I think it was 1.26 this year. And last year it was, I think, 0.15.
Correct.
It was very low. It was almost essentially one.
Year,
right.
So 1 to 17, 18, is that
closer to reality? The further you are to the left, the closer you are to reality.
Well, but 17, 18 is a set. The cap has been set by the controller.
Well, the 17-18, right, we're still working through the calculations, but for all of these, you know, we have the information, and we will be able to firm up the 17-18 number. When you get out to these numbers, essentially I'm taking the factors that we see in 17-18 and projecting them out to be the same, and they're not going to be. They're going to be different one way or another.
It's a misnomer of the 2% tax cap. It's not
right.
A 2% tax cap. It's not. So,
right.
As you can see, last year we were a negative tax cap. It looks like in our initial calculations for 17-18, we'll be in a negative tax cap.
So a reduction. Again, the third. If you wanted to hit a key point, Mark, third year in a row of reduced tax levies. You know, just... Well, the pilot ends right here. So there's the pilot payment coming across, and then it ends. So
June of 21?
by the 21-22, as we go into 21-22 school year, they'll have no more pilot payment. And that's why you see, though, because of the intricacies of the calculation, when you enter into a pilot, it's almost like a penalty in terms of your tax cap. But then when you exit, because of the way your calculation's set, you get a significant boost. Because right now, you know, based on the numbers that we've used, you know, we go from 1 year at a 1.47% tax cap, the next year you're over 6.
Way too theoretical at that point. We only have any level of real confidence in the 17-18 numbers up there. Each year you go out, it gets less and less confident. It's just more of a projection.
Yeah, it's just,
who knows what the calculation will be for the growth factor, for the regional factor. That's derived each year. And there's a lot of legislation flying around up in Albany right now. So that deals with the cap, that deals with foundation aid. So there's so many unknown variables that this is more of a theoretical projection as opposed to a real prediction.
And we do have a meeting scheduled for next week with the town of Marlboro and the town of Newburgh regarding the pilot. And you know, although we have a number of years before that agreement set to expire, we think it's advantageous to have a game plan of how we might address that, because they may seek additional pilot beyond that. In theory, yes.
Really, the biggest takeaway that Pat and I have discussed regarding this is that we are confident that we will be able to deliver for this Board of Education and this community a tax cap compliant budget that allows a strong program for our children. That's really the takeaway that we have. Even with a negative tax cap, we have a level of confidence that we're going to be fine. And the broader piece on the long-term economics here is that reserves line, because one of the things that Pat has impressed upon all of us, and we all as a team have worked very hard at, is controlling our expenditures to ensure that we can maintain a reserve that's favorable. That helps us in fiscal stress tests so that we can weather storms.
I'm
very confident that we are going to be able to accomplish all of that as we look at this. So that's really our takeaway early in this process.
Right, because we built those reserves specifically knowing that we had some financial challenges once the emergency state aid and the prior year adjustment revenues dropped off, which was last year. So this year was the first year where we had no emergency aid, no prior year adjustment. The emergency aid, you know, for the previous year, this number was $3.2 million, and for the 2 years previous to that, that number was $4 million. And now we have zeros, which is why we see the allocation both of reserves and fund balance, but it does diminish as we go forward and maintains, you know, a very decent position. And again, you can see, you know, from last year, what we looked at, to this year, what we're looking at. So, you know, every year it's worth looking at, because, you know, we've got so many variables in here that are changing constantly. This at least just kind of gives you an idea of what our longer term fiscal health looks like. Okay. Any other questions?
Just looking at the aid revenue, the textbook aid line is decreased, and it just was making me curious.
When I put the numbers in, I think this number may have been a miscalculation, and I want to look at that. Uh-huh. I don't think we dropped this far. I think this number had some of these numbers wrapped up into it, and it wasn't pulled out. But again, it's, you know, budget, it's semi-reality, right?
Right. Well, my larger thought process is, with the Chromebook initiative, do we have a vision that will take us to more of an e-textbook environment in order to be saving on those expenditures?
We have a vision. Textbook companies don't.
Well, I certainly...
So that's something that we're going to be struggling with for some time.
That.
Yeah, they still want to get their dollar, whether or not we buy it in paper form or electronic form.
Sometimes but they're more expensive.
That is the projection. This particular aid is a direct expense-based aid based on enrollment. So there's an allocation that the state gives you per child.
It's about $58.
Of aid, and it's spend it, get it. So that's it's direct reimbursement up to an amount.
Yeah.
But the potentially where this got combined, there's three expense-based aids that are really interchangeable. The textbook aid, the technology aid, and the library aid, correct? Or no, computer software, technology, and textbook.
These all here are...
It's really interchangeable. It's how we allocate it out. So, but we absolutely see that in our future. But it's still going to... Publishers are still trying to figure out a way...
Our future or our future?
Yes. Yes, both.
Okay.
But textbooks aren't going to get cheaper because they're electronic. That's really a bigger piece of
this. And I understand that. Yeah. But I'm just... thinking about
well you would think it would because a thick textbook like this that costs $85 or $100 that is now just a PDF
well if they're going to lose on one end they're going to try to get you on another
right
end.
Which you know tells full you that well. The printing costs right
yeah
so
the electronic ones in the college are no cheaper than the printed ones were
no.
We think we've seen a couple instances where there actually seem to be more expensive in the electronic format which makes no sense
because they add interactive pieces to it, and then they say it's an enhanced offering. So,
all right, so as I said previously, we will come back and look at this projection when we're to the end of this budget process, so we at least know our 17-18 numbers should be very firm, which should help firm up all the future numbers from there, too.
Pat, since we know we're looking at a negative cap, but we don't really know the exact number, correct? Are we facing another power plant shift this year?
Another what?
The shift, like last year we had a negative cap, but the taxes still went up because of the shift?
The Roaston facility continues to devalue. There's a court-ordered reduction in assessment. It was over the course of 6 years, but the large decreases in value have been absorbed already. So although we still see drops, you'll still see some effect of that. You know, but it all depends too on the overall value of the community. So, you know, have we seen growth in Marlboro, Plattekill, and Newburgh could offset some of that reduction in taxable assessed value for the Roaston facility?
Okay.
Well, and a key thing I think this year going forward, because we saw it with Newburgh last year, is their assessed value for that area went up.
Right.
In our district area.
Right. That's why that's kind of how we weathered that bump that we were expecting to see when we entered into the pilot. There was enough growth within the district that it significantly cut into that projected increase. So, you know, we were able to have a very reasonable increase when we, at one point several years ago, thought that was going to be a significant cliff.
And hopefully now that the county's taken over some of those duties.
Yes.
They'll actually do an evaluation and get away from this worried about the ratio aid.
Right. Yeah, because the assessor was an interesting fellow. He's no longer
on
there.
On that topic, too, Pat and I spend time in Albany, and we will be spending time again in Albany. And one of the primary topics that we had discussions with Senator Larkin, and I've had some conversation with Assemblyman Scartados, is legislation that has been at the state level, and we're asking it to be reintroduced again with support from our local people, is providing a seat at the table during pilot negotiations through towns, because you know that the taxing agency of the school district is not required to be at the table when a township is determining the value or the amount of a pilot payment in lieu of taxes. We look at this as a very different situation than when typically pilots are put together. When typically pilots are put together, the town is trying to entice a business to come into the community. And they do that through some type of a pilot agreement that helps the business predict their tax scenario for a period of time.
And a pilot on new money is neutral
is
to
money.
Us because it's new
it's
money,
new
right.
Money.
A pilot on existing money is a problem, and that's
so our,
what
right,
this was.
Our legislative request, which is also supported by a number of other entities, including the School Boards Association, is to get school districts a seat at that table and a signature on the final outcome of the pilot. If that doesn't work, we also have now established a relationship with the town of Marlboro to get ahead of the curve and start working with the town of Newburgh now in anticipation of what's coming with the tax, with the pilot renegotiation potentially coming down the line. So I'm appreciative of the town taking some leadership on that and really doing some homework and including us in that process. Pat spent some time with the initial meeting, and we have a scheduled meeting next week with the three entities that we hope will establish a nice relationship going forward to help us in the long run. I mean, it's a bifurcated approach, looking at Albany and looking at local.
And you have the big unknown now with the agreement to shut down the power plant in Westchester.
Yeah.
That's going to change the energy market considerably without that nuclear power plant. So
right. And
nobody really wants to be entering into anything until they know where that's all going.
And unfortunately, we're still under the court order devaluation of Roeston. So until that bottoms out, there won't be any potential for in growth and revenue there, and we're tied into the pilot. And just to put the pilot into perspective, you see this number one, that total pilot payment they're making is about 1.5 million, and we're getting about 1.12 of it. So, but we have no seat at the table, right?
I think the number is close to 70-something percent. The school district receives 70-something percent of the revenue.
I don't remember the whole pilot, but I think Frank would. Isn't there after they make so much electricity?
It's only for generation, but the reality of it is those things are all going to happen. You know, the shutdown and all of that are beyond when the pilot runs out.
Right.
And when the devaluation runs out. So that's not, none of that's going to affect the current pilot. It's if they try and get in to something new before they're done that could affect the outgrowth going down.
Correct. And there is the caveat under the existing pilot that if they increase beyond 25% run rate, then or there's a certain megawatt production that they would pass additional revenues on through the pilot process. But I think they were quick to agree to that because they have no intention of actually ever doing that.
To it.
Right.
If it's 25, they'll go to 24. If it's 20, they'll go to 19.
You know, the issue with the Dan Scammer plant is that they had to pay a significant premium on their fuel, on the natural gas, so that they would take priority over other customers. So their cost structure is just so high that, you know, we actually probably want to hope that Dan Scammer doesn't become profitable, because that means we're going to paying a lot for energy. Because every day they bid to produce energy and they give a price, and the New York State Independent System Operator kind of doles out and looks at what the demand is, and then the prices start to layer in. They start with the cheapest power, they move up the chain, and if they don't reach the price that Dan Scammer bid, then Dan Scammer doesn't run for the day. And but I believe that was their business model from the beginning. They just wanted the capacity payments. They get paid by the New York State Independent System Operator just to sit there ready to produce electricity.
In all fairness, we're talking millions of dollars a year. We're not talking pennies of what they're getting paid to not run.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's right. That's why I never really understood what was going on with this as a pilot, because they had already made significant investment. I think they had paid $8 million into a bond. They had several million dollars into rehabilitating the facility. But the town of Newburgh acted like if they didn't get the pilot, they were going to walk away. And I don't think that was ever going to happen.
It was guaranteed money. I remember having the meetings with him personally. It was guaranteed money. They knew exactly what they were doing.
Absolutely.
Town of Newburgh went for it. And
this just increased their profitability is all it did. They were going to be profitable whether they had that or not. Okay, thank you.
So to encourage some level of input, some of the themes that I'm starting to see develop out of our discussions, so that you can just get some sense of what I'm interpreting from our directors and our principals, is that this budget will have a support focus. It'll have a safety and security focus, and opportunities, advanced opportunities for students, or additional opportunities for students. Supports like social, emotional, academic, safety and security is obvious, and expansion of opportunities for students that in our current system may not have paths of opportunity for So those are some of the themes that I saw develop out of our level of discussion. So I'm open to hearing perspectives as far as where you'd like us to be.
Can you give me an example of what you're suggesting?
What's the budget? I don't have one. I honestly don't have one yet, but there are some thoughts that were presented and discussed today that would expand course opportunities for students at the high school, options as far as electives, support options or support mechanisms for students that are students and families, quite honestly, that are in need of emotional and social supports so that they can be academically successful. Academic supports, because there's true performance gaps between where a student is performing and where they should be performing. Safety and security is obvious as far as what that means. As far as the details go, we're really working through what that means administratively for us. I think that that part of the budget will have an extraordinary focus from my perspective, that I really want some input from the community and this board as far as what values does this Board of Education and this community want from a safety and security perspective for schools. I already mentioned the expansion of opportunities in electives for children that we currently don't have right now at the high school. So those are some themes that I'm seeing in the requests. I don't know where I am yet as far as what I would like to present to the board, because I haven't processed it enough yet. We're really doing a lot of input and a lot of dialogue, and I need to chew on some things to digest a little bit. We spent a lot of time today talking, and I need some time to digest before I'm comfortable to present actual things with associated costs. Regardless of that, what you'll end up seeing in the next three meetings really is a genesis of thoughts and ideas that will ultimately arrive at a list of priorities that we'll have come to consensus on as a full group. What we can pay for is 100% dependent upon what that final aid package looks like. Because we will not put something together for this community that we can't afford. So we will make sure that we are tax cap compliant, which is negative, Mark, under zero, less than zero.
Almost minus one.
That's almost minus one. So we will be there. And we will assure that our long-term fiscal health is a high priority. So what the final outcome is, no idea yet.
I was going to say, we also have to go slow. Because we have taken a big tax hit here in Marlborough and in Newburgh when they shut down that power plant. So for me, I think we need to really seriously look at the programs that we had. We did take away a lot of programs. And I just get a little nervous about putting them back in place. And then another year, when the pilot's not here or going up or down, we have to take them away. Because it's not fair to the children and things that they are doing.
I respect that. I'm
very nervous about doing that and saying, here, this is our wish list, this is what we'd like. What can we accomplish out of that wish list without, because a lot of our taxpayers are also stressed. Mm-hmm. So that's what I get a little nervous about. I mean, I love bringing the programs, but again, on the other hand, we have to pay for them.
Yep.
Because the state is not doing a lot of reimbursing. So that's what I would just ask everyone to be a little bit considerate of.
The other thing, and I know Pat is always here, so I don't worry about it with Pat, but I think that everybody just try to remember is, it's a negative tax cap, but whatever we put together needs to be right up against what the cap is. Because it's negative, you can't put more towards it to make it even lower, because all that does is compound worse as you go out. So yes, we want to try and do as much for as little, but we need to stay as close to the cap as absolutely possible, especially in a negative year, where it's just going to compound your issues going forward. You know, if we determine that we're worried about the rate, we can do stuff after it's passed to a flood balance that won't hurt you retroactively. But going out initially, you got to be at or just below the tax cap.
And you know, thank you, Frank. I appreciate that. And I think that the board and the public can see in the numbers and the way that we had a report from our auditor in the fall, and certainly looking at these projections. And again, each year you go out, the projections become a little more gray, or a little less gray, I guess, more gray. But I want you to know that we've gotten to this point. A clear direction from this group with full buy-in is you need to make sure you rub every single buffalo off of every single nickel before you spend it. We have to. It's essential because they matter, every single one of them. So that has borne fruit for us. We're doing well with our nickels, so keep going. It's a testament to the team that's in front of you here, so I appreciate what they do. At the same time, we need to advance academically. We need to. It's a bifurcated approach.
I just say it puts us, you know, again, we've done that where we've given and we've had to take back. And any school district would want to get 10 or 15 more teachers if the money was there. I would love to do that here, but we don't have the money. School district that is like this now. More and more school districts are becoming more and more strapped. So it gets a little harder for our children to get educated.
All right. With that, we're going to move on to our regular business, starting with personnel recommendations. Resolved that the Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools, approves the following personnel recommendations as presented. Motion for approval of personnel recommendations. Joanne, second. Frank, any discussion? Russell?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Susan?
Yes.
Frank?
Yes.
Joanne?
Yes.
Myself, yes. On to contracts for the evening. Resolved that the Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools, approves and authorizes the Superintendent of Schools to sign the Memorandum of Agreement between the Marlboro Central School District and the Marlboro UPSEU Paraprofessional Unit covering the period of July 1st, 2015 through June 30th, 2020. Motion for approval of contracts. James, second. Joanne, any discussion?
Yes. What is the actual education of a sign language interpreter? To know sign language? One.
It's varied, but Rose, can you speak to that? Do you have the answer for that, or do we need to get back to them?
There's specific qualifications for sign language interpreters. It's not a teaching certificate, per se, but then you have to go through a program, and there's some programs to the state that they can go through.
Is it a licensed program? I mean, is the person licensed when they're done, or is it more of an accreditation? Okay.
So would they have to have a bachelor's degree, or they could have a high school diploma and get the certificate, is my question. So what do we, for the suggested salaries, what are we requiring?
That they have that accreditation. We're going to get the right terminology for you. I just need to look into it. This particular situation arose last year where we couldn't find one. We tried to find one, couldn't, and we were contracting out. That salary is actually about a third of the cost of contracting out. So that's where the genesis of that came from. Even having that in there, now there's a mechanism for us, but it doesn't mean that we literally had one applicant for the last need. Well, two, but one.
And then,
right.
And then, so we have an applicant. And
Yeah.
Wasn't it close to like $800 a day?
Sure. No, I understand that. How many do we currently have?
Just one.
One. My other question is...
Yeah. The question was...
I'm sorry. Yeah. The question I asked was, do we need that person full-time? Thank you.
My other question is on this MOA number 7, the third page, in the event a unit member, in the event a unit member hired prior to ratification is subsequently hired as a teaching assistant, he or she shall be placed on the new salary schedule at the step closest to his or her current salary without a loss in pay. How many do we currently have that this affects? Do we know?
Right now, none, because we haven't hired, correct, Pat? Because we haven't hired anyone under the new scenario.
Okay.
So correct. That's more or less for someone that changes categories.
Right.
Oh, okay.
So if they're, for example, if they're a teaching aide and
yes.
they would like to become a teaching assistant, they're not going to be harmed in the transfer.
In that process, we had sought a more reasonable schedule for teaching assistants for new hires, and part of that through the negotiation process was that people had concerns if they were moving from say like a classroom aide to a teaching assistant that they would take a considerable reduction in pay and that it would disincentivize them to do that. So
I was thinking in my mind that we currently had say within the last few months or whatever, hired X amount, and this would apply to that.
Oh, I think we haven't posted
none
anything.
None that I'm aware of. None.
Okay.
Right.
Other questions on the contract? Russell?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Susan?
Yes.
Frank?
Yes.
Joanne?
Yes.
And myself, yes. Item number 8, our non-resident tuition rates for 2015-16 and estimated 2016-17. Resolved, the Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools, approves the following non-resident tuition rates for the 2015-16 school year as presented, and resolved that the Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools, approves the estimated non-resident tuition rates for the 2016-17 school year as follows as presented. Motion for approval of non-resident tuition rates for 2015 and estimated 2016-17. James, second. Joanne, discussion.
Do we have anyone that's paying tuition at this time?
I don't think so right now.
Okay. Thank you.
Russell, go ahead.
And this, just to clarify, these are based on what our costs are. Right, they take our total budget. That's why we always have the estimate and the final. Just for the public, it's a real eye-opener when you look at the finals for 15-16. That's what it cost, according to the state, for us to educate every regular student and special education student for that fiscal year, that school year.
And this action provides a mechanism if we were to, for example, have a program in district that someone from outside the district would like to afford themselves of, that is allowed under board policy, this action sets the mechanism for how much they would have to pay for that.
How many have we had over, say, the course of the last few years? Any idea?
I don't know.
But it's a formality. Every district has to do it because that's how we get billed.
Yeah, no. I understand that. Yeah. I was just curious.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that why we put the new system in with the police department? Was to check the residents? Because wouldn't it be someone that is...
This is allowable, though. That's when there's someone that's trying to do something that they're not allowed to do. Board policy allows tuition-paying students.
Yeah.
So if they want to write us the check to come here,
right.
for example, one of our exemplary special ed programs, we would advertise tonight, the doors are open, write the check. That certainly is an effort that we are looking at. But someone that's coming to the school district and hiding from us as a non-resident and not paying tuition, that system helps us identify those
people. Right, but what I'm saying is if they are here and we do find out, wouldn't they go underneath the tuition base?
No, they would be directed to enroll in their district of residence.
Even if they wanted to stay?
If they want to stay, they can write the check.
Okay, that's fair.
Right.
Right, but I mean, I'm saying, you know.
Yes.
Sometimes it's...
Write the check.
Right.
Other questions, comments on the resident tuition rates? Russell?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Susan?
Yes.
Frank?
Yes.
Joanne?
Yes.
Myself, yes. Is there any old business this evening?
I just want to make a note on the Orange County School Boards Association 2017 legislative platform. They did make a note down at the bottom to recognize the cognitive, social, and physical benefits of daily free play time for students by assisting districts in identifying ways to implement and or increase recess time for elementary students. It could make none before.
I forgot to mention, too, Russell, that I did talk about that with Senator Larkin as well when we were up in Albany.
Thank you.
Other old business.
Did we find out any further information on the board docs presentation?
I was just going to raise it when you folks were done. We are currently trying to schedule James Page to come down and meet with us administratively so we can understand the back side of the system and how it works. And then... ultimately make a recommendation as part of the budget process. I did get quotes, and the quotes are a little bit more than what was presented that night for the two different tiers because BOCES tax on an administrative fee. But regardless, we're going to get back an aid of somewhere in the 50 to 60%, I believe, range. Correct, Patrick? Somewhere in 40 to 60% of the cost we'll get back in aid the following year. So once we're in the aid cycle, it literally costs us 40% of the actual total bill.
Yeah.
So if the total bill was $10,000, the output net would be $4,000.
It was nice. Monday I watched the meeting because obviously I was away. It was nice to see I was listening to them do their presentation, and at the same time, because I was at the computer, I could bring up Wappinger's page myself and see it. It was amazing the ability to go back and find documents and to see actually how that worked and how much easier it was than to find anything that we have. Sorry.
Well, it also helps with transparency because it puts all of our business that is
out there,
that is public business, in a publicly searchable database. And I think that that's an important element. We just want to look, for the due diligence side, we want to see what does it mean for us administratively. I'm gathering that there's a lot of simplicity on our side of it to create that budget process. But until I have him down in the office and showing us, I want to see under the hood. That's really what it is.
Any other old business? Is there any new business?
I have a couple of things. The Orange County School Boards Association Legislation Day, which will be up in Albany on February 12th through the 13th. It's where we go meet different senators and assemblymen to talk about the platform that New York State School Board is backing for legislation and with the school districts. And then you get a little time to, you know, talk with them also about what you need. So if anyone wanted to go, I was just curious if anybody from the district is going. I normally go every year, but I do have the times that we are scheduled to go if anyone wants to go, you know.
It would be great if she goes.
We have the paperwork, right?
Yeah, anything to support it would be great. I know Patrick and I are going to be taking a number of other visits up to Albany, but also locally here in the legislative offices. So just anything we can do to support that effort is
I think, an important effort. So
it's a good thing because it's not only our school district, all the school districts go, and they support it, and they go talk to the assembly and the senators. And we hand them a piece of paper saying what we're looking for, what our legislation platform is. And one of the things that they did add last night was the salary cap for the BOCES superintendent, because there is a cap on his salary. So we want to be bringing that to them, and the TRS also was one of the things that they want to add to it. So that was it as far as Orange Ulster BOCES going. If anyone wants to go, we can talk about it. And my other new business is, I'd like to know if I can get it approved for the school board's conference that's in October. This way, when it does open up, we can get the hotel and all that. It will be up at Lake Placid. So I need your approval before we can do that. So
I make a motion that Joanne go again this year to represent us.
I'll second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Good to go.
Thank you. And that's it for me.
Any other new business? I do have one question. I got an email the other day, and I got this cool brochure, which is from Aramark, which is a food service advisory company that happens to do school lunch programs and advising, things of that nature. Have we ever, I know I asked you the question already, but for the record, have we ever looked into contracting with a company like this to help with our program, to look and see if there's any kind of cost benefit to get Fred the help that they could offer?
Not that I'm aware of. We can
I think
have
when,
dialogue on it.
I think when prior to my arrival here, when they were going through the closing of the buildings and looking, they did do an examination of both food service and facilities outsourcing. I don't know. I wasn't here for it. I know there's a lot of issues associated with that in terms of control and quality control and things of that nature. I know there are a couple school districts. I think Minnesing Valley, just within the last 4 or 5 years, has contracted out. But we have not looked at that recently.
Is this something we could just put on a list of things to look at? I'm not saying that's something we should do. I'd just be curious to know if they offer.
Yeah, we could talk to them.
I imagine aside from doing a whole soup to nuts program, they also offer advice and
we could talk. I don't know that they do. I think that they just come in and they start running it. Like they're not a consultant.
The brochure that I read yesterday said that you use your own staff. So it's quite possible that they help administer the program, or perhaps
we
help
look
with
into
your buying
it.
Power. I know buying food when you have 1,000 school districts is probably a lot cheaper than buying it on your own. So just something to keep in mind.
Sure.
It's one of the things that when I was up in Buffalo, there are a couple people that do that, and they do represent that, and I have brought it back in the past. But majority of them like to come in and
take it over. I was curious to see what our options
might be. And they will use your staff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We'll take a look at it.
So.
Other new business for the evening? Any other items for the evening? At this time, we'll have people from the audience an opportunity to address the Board of Education. If you have questions or comments for the board, please approach the podium, speak into the microphone, state your name and town, and address the Board of Education. Any questions or comments tonight from the public? We do not have an executive session scheduled for this evening. So with that, motion to adjourn. Russell, second. James, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? See you in 2 weeks.